Today we are going to discuss about how immersive technology is going to shape user experience. There's a quite very difference between designing for 2D screens and designing for 3D spaces. But whatever change it might take, one thing remains same. The design should be user-centric. Let's see how things should be done. So with emerging technology and rapid growth of the technology, UX is central of this growth. Because if people are supposed to adopt these technologies, they should be comfortable of using them in their daily lives. Before understanding how XR is shaping the user experience, let's try to understand what XR is and other similar terms like AR, VR, mixed reality, and many other terms you're listening. But there's a problem that there's a great confusion around these terms. Let's try to have a clarity among this. So like for any field of science, you have a scale. For virtual reality, we have a thing called virtual continuum. In the virtual continuum, you have two ends. One is virtual reality, where you mean 100% CGI, computer generated graphics. On the other end, you have 100% reality. For example, this is 100% reality. In between, you have a combination of AR, virtual reality and reality. The most popular one is augmented reality. What makes something to call augmented reality? If the environment is real and the objects are virtual, you call it augmented reality. There is one more unpopular case, that is augmented virtuality. Where environment is virtual and objects are real, you call it augmented virtuality. So what makes something immersive reality? Something with mixed reality where you have 3D effects of audio, simulated noise effects, all this adds to immersive technology. Let's try to see how a generic things like copy-paste works in 3D spaces. How do you do copy-paste in 2D screens? With mouse clicks, keyboard. Let's try to see how things work in 3D. You just do a 3D scanning of an object, just move it. The virtually simulated object looks similar to the real one. With 3D spaces, you can also copy-paste real-life objects, like we can do the text in the 2D screens. So it's very simple. Let's try to understand how things work different from 2D screens. So, looking at the evolution of the screens we look at, earlier it was theaters, we have very distant screens. Then it reduced to the TVs, which are comparatively near. Then we have computers, which are a little more closer. Then we have mobile screens, which almost came to us, you know, with centimeters of difference. Now we have head-mounted devices for virtual reality. Almost attached to your body. It's like virtual organs of your body. Let's try to understand how things work with virtual reality. So let's try to understand how interactions will look in 3D spaces. With Skype call, you do in 2D screens. Mozilla has a product called Mozilla Hubs, where you have 3D characters, you feel immersive into the conversation, where you can see the depth of the characters nearby you. You can walk, you can touch, you can interact with your friends. Let's try to understand how XR will change UX of devices we interact with. Let's see this example. Can anyone say the differences between how to design an XR experience for 2D screens and virtual reality spaces? Did you notice any differences? There are some differences. When you design for VR scenes, it should almost feel as you are dealing with real life objects. For example, if I am in a real life, I want to switch off a light or turn off the speed of the fan, the design is different. In virtual reality, you have to design almost closer to your real life experience. There are some good practices of virtual reality. The best US practices of virtual reality are the four main important points you have to remember are the virtual reality experiences you design should be believable. If you create a virtual reality experiences, it almost looks like a Cartoon Network show. It doesn't make any sense that to create a VR experience. The VR experience you create should be believable as close as to a real life scene. The second thing should be the VR experience should be interactive. If you create a VR scene which has only plain walls or, you know, nothing much to interact, still it doesn't make any sense to have a VR experience. The third point should be the VR scenes you create should be explorable. Because that's how things work in real life. And one more thing we have to be careful about when creating XR experiences is, likewise, we take care about each and every detail in 2D screens, about the color palette, of the font sizes, everything. When you design for 3D experiences, you should be careful about everything. If you have this, the light we are seeing now have a different effect of the color of the chair now. If you switch off the lights, can you see the difference between red or blue? So, what is the color of my t-shirt? Almost white? Okay. But the color of our clothes would differ with the quality of light. So when you dip a cloth in the water, it changes the color. It doesn't actually change the physical nature of the color, but it's optical illusion. Because the direction of light, quality of light, luminosity of light, all these parameters do affect how we think in real life. The same principles would apply for creating XR experiences. So when you create XR experiences, you should be very careful about where do you put the light element. And you should also be very careful about how many lumens you're setting for it. And one more experience is, you feel immersive because likewise with light, you should also have a 3D sound. In 2D, you just have sound from only one direction. But in real life, if you're in a jungle, in a safari, you can figure out where the sound came from. And also, you can also figure out what the nature of sound is. If it's from a predator, if it's from a lion, tiger, or is it from your fellow human being, you can figure out from the nature of the sound. So also with immersive technology, you have to figure out that where to put the sound. So likewise, you select Cartesian coordinate system for the visual elements, you should also be particular about the Cartesian coordinate system of audio files. So in immersive tech, you have 3D audio. So the difference between 2D audio and 3D audio is, if you want to make someone feel like a sound coming from a different place, you have to place the audio file way far away from the center of point. If you want to make someone feel like an object is approaching them very faster or closer, you have to be very particular about the audio file being closer to them and moving fast to them. So immersive technology is not just about the visual elements, it's also about how you care about the audio elements and other sensor elements. So the general utilities, like how we do web browsing in 2D, and let's also look at how we do web browsing in 3D. So if you look at it, it's no more a rectangular or flat screen. For 3D, you have to design everything as sphere. Also, if you look at the controls, it's not just mouse. If you use devices that enable VR, if you have seen Oculus Go, you have controllers. So, in the place of mouse, you have controller now. In 2D, you have only two devices. One is mouse and second one is keyboard. But when you design for 3D spaces, you have more devices. Let's also try to understand what are the different types of devices we have. When you're dealing with 3D spaces, you have a factor called degrees of freedom. Let's try to understand what is degrees of freedom. By looking at 3DOF, 3 degrees of freedom, consider the center of your head as the center of Cartesian coordinate system. So think of the XYZ axis. If you put your head mount device on your head, you can rotate your head horizontally, vertically, also on third axis. This is 3DOF. So by using these devices, the general VR devices we have is 3DOF. We also have advanced VR devices with 6DOF, 6 degrees of freedom. You'll have another Cartesian coordinate system at the center of your body. So you can also sync that with the sensors in your mobile or any other device. So attached to the 3DOF at the head, the other 3DOF will make you feel like you are also immersed in the real scene. If you move, your virtual reality character also moves in the scene. If you jump, the virtual reality character also jumps. So all the moves you make in XYZ axis, your virtual reality character simulates the same thing. So one more thing we have to understand is virtual reality also has real life consequences. For example, if you're designing for a 2D, if you have all your pages in the sidebar menu, or if you have everything in your navbar menu, it's pretty much fine to have, you know, to 2D experience. But if you do the same thing with a 3D experience, you're forcing your user to move your neck all the time. If you force your user to move his neck for more than 5 minutes, he'll die with the body pains. Okay? But so, because when you're designing for 3D spaces, you shouldn't make your user discomfortable. And one more thing we also have to understand is the wide angle for virtual reality is 90 degrees. For the real life, we have 180 degrees. But the general devices for VR, we have only for 90 degrees. So you have to also be conscious about when you're designing a VR scene, try to limit the angle to 90 degrees. And one more thing, if you're not careful about the real life consequences, if you're making your user, if you put elements that move very fastly with high velocity, if you make your user jump fastly, that's not similar to the real life, they'll fall to motion sickness. So if you don't design your VR properly, you'll make your user run to a nearest bucket. They will tend to be vomiting, nausea, body aches, everything. So to make sure your VR scene is motion sickness proof, you should also be very conscious about the velocity of all the elements in your VR scene. So if any UX designer here is planning to start designing for 3D spaces, it's a very simple thing. Everyone can start it. Just try to understand how XR works. What are the new input formats we have? All these days we only have keyboards and mouses. Now we have user input. Now we have look controls. We have additional controls, hand controls. And try to understand the new vocabulary in the XR domain, like we were listening to the second slide. And let's try to understand the difference between head tracking and motion tracking. So ultimately, XR is a very new domain. It opens a lot much of scope for UX designers, but with a twist. Twist here is, you have limited options when you're using for 2D flat screens. All you have is hardly pointing and clicking. But when you're designing for 3D spaces, you have many parameters to take care of. It could be face recognition, voice recognition, head tracking, motion tracking, and near possibly brain waves. So this is where we end the talk. We can move for Q&A.
Nice talk, sort of here.
Thanks.
So my question is, like, whenever I'm designing for a 2D, as the elements are limited, my audience are big. Now when I'm designing for this 3D world, this XR system, the adaptability is still very low. We have very the adaptability, the user, the count of user is very low. Why is the point of putting that much effort now in this system? Is there a reason I should go and invest this much time and design something for VR when my VR user is very limited? This is a very nice user's base.
Yeah,
and I have never seen someone actually trying to explore and buying something on a regular basis. So let's say I've just taken an example. Let's say I'm an Amazon guy. I'm trying to design an interface for VR. Whereas my people who come and have fun on a VR will not actually convert into an end user. Is that still a valid time to put into this space?
Very good question. Thanks for asking. So all these days, the immersive tech is limited to R&D. And this is the time, it's 2018, last few months, it's in the market. So as it was said, all these days, it was referred as a niche technology, or, you know, with limited user base, limited geeks. But it's into the mainstream now. How many of you played Pokemon Go? So pretty much everyone, right? Pokemon Go, it's a very viral game. It's one of the first AR game to, you know, to become so viral. So the lakhs of people who started walking out of their rooms, who never walked around with the XR technology. That's one thing. And there are many new apps and, you know, across the business with Oculus and other things. So the XR users now, in 2019 are, you know, are less, but by 2020, it's expected, not very far. In within 2 years, we're expected that around 20% of web users will start using XR experiences as a regular use. That's the reason Amazon have started Sumerian, Google has started their own AR platform, Mozilla have started Mixed Reality. So all the big bees and all those small startups started jumping into it, predicting the near future. So everyone is, you know, trying to be the primers to capture the market.
Now we can move